Hello friends, I'm Santhanam from Smart Leaders IAS, and in this video, we will be looking at the editorials which came on the 25th of February. The first article that we are going to look at is titled, Better Pay Means Less Corruption. And this article is about the argument that better pay for bank employees may not end in bank-related scams like that of the recent PNB scam. So, what exactly is the argument? There are two arguments which are placed. The first argument is, if wages and compensation for bank employees or government employees in general are improved, scams and corruption is less likely to arise. This is the first argument. The second argument is, we can just privatize all the banks so that all the fraudulent practices which are prevailing in the public sector banks can be gotten rid of. The rationale behind these arguments are that already public sector bank managers are paid very low, which means that there is no incentive for them to work harder or work without any external benefits in the form of corruption or bribery. Also, private banks have lower non-performing assets in comparison to the public sector banks, which means the private banks are good at managing their loans and recovering their loans. In terms of the fraudulent acts, we can see that there are fewer fraud reports in the private banks in compared to the public sector government banks. Moreover, a customer always feels that the financial services provided by the private banks is superior in terms of quality and quantity with regards to any public sector bank. So let's first look at the first argument, which is increasing the wages. This idea of increasing the wages, it actually came about through the Global Indicators Group of the World Bank, which laid out strategies, a six-step strategy to combat corruption. What it says is that in order to tackle corruption, the first thing that you have to do is pay the civil servants well. Secondly, you have to create transparency and openness in the governance and spending. The third is cut red tape. Red tape is proven to be one of the main reasons for corruption. So reducing it or cutting it out completely will help in reducing corruption. Fourthly, replacing subsidies with targeted cash transfers. In India, this is actually taking place right now in the form of direct benefit transfer. And the fifth point is establishing international conventions to control cross-border corruption. Finally, deployment of smart technology and implementation of e-governance. Well, does improved wages really decrease corruption? They conducted a study in West Africa and they found that increased wages in Ghana, Burkina Faso, and South Africa did not result in reduced corruption. On the contrary, it actually increased corruption levels among traffic policemen in Ghana. Also, they noticed that in South Africa, better paid and worse paid employees of the government are equally corrupt. There is no difference between the amount of corruption based on the amount of salary an employee receives. However, it is found that in hospitals in South Africa, better audit and supervision mechanisms reported lower levels of corruption. This means regulation and more auditing will lead to more scrutiny of corruptive practices. So that can actually lead to decrease in corruption. All the changes which we saw earlier are actually being implemented aggressively in India, and India is getting some benefits. However, the direct link between implementing these decisions with regards to the reduction in corruption is yet to be established. What about the second argument, which is privatizing the banks? See, you can say that the private banks have less NPAs in comparison to the public sector banks, but the private banks also have less market share with respect to in comparison to the public sector banks. So in relative terms, they are both having the same amount of NPA. Also, one has to keep in mind that most bank failures in India have been happening in the cooperative and private banking sector. The conclusion is, instead of knee-jerk responses, the government has to tighten scrutiny and oversight mechanisms in banks to prevent similar such scams happening in the future. Moving on to the next article, which is titled Sustaining the Momentum. This article is about tackling tuberculosis with a renewed effort. Last year, there was a GMC, Global Ministerial Conference, on ending tuberculosis within the sustainable development era. It brought together ministers from major countries, 80 major countries, and they discussed TB elimination efforts amongst them. And this year they are going to meet in New York at the UN General Assembly high level meeting on tuberculosis. Now the author actually focuses on two aspects for tackling tuberculosis. The first is focusing on research and development with regards to tuberculosis. See, despite World Health Organization's end TB strategy, TB research remains severely underfunded. And in the GMC, the Global Ministerial Conference meeting, the countries have agreed to increase their tuberculosis research spending. India in this case has taken a leadership role and has established the India TB Research Consortium under the ICMR, Indian Council for Medical Research, to spearhead the research effort. The second measure which has to be taken is vaccination for tuberculosis. So far, the only licensed vaccination for TB is BCG, and this was actually invented in the 1920s. So you can understand that it has been almost close to 100 years since there was any improvement in the TB vaccination. With 1.7 million deaths, TB is deadlier than HIV, malaria, or even Ebola. And yet it receives only $100 million a year, which is a fraction of the research investment on its vaccine, which is received by tuberculosis research groups. So the research funding has to improve, and only with that we will be able to tackle the problem of tuberculosis. So what is the way forward? As far as India is concerned, the Indo-US Vaccine Action Program between India's DBT, Department of Biotechnology, National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, and the National Institute of Health of the United States, they are both supporting each other in terms of immunization and vaccine research. The Department of Biotechnology's National Biopharma Mission also aims to promote product discovery, translational research, and early stage manufacturing of vaccines in the country. So these are welcome steps in terms of tackling TB. And if we sustain this momentum, we will be able to eradicate tuberculosis by 2050.